this honor and privilege for me to welcome you all on behalf of the AKCP with the blessing of Almighty, our founder, Chairman Kalvi Vallar Deivathireddy Kalasalingam Ayya, and with the support of our beloved Chairman Ilai Vallal Dr. K. Sridharan sir, I am here to welcome the welcome address for this 46th International Virtual Learning Series in association with the Indian Pharmaceutical Association, South Tamil Nadu Local Branch, Head Office at Arulmigu Kalasalingam College of Pharmacy. Yes, today I feel very much honored to welcome can you hear?
I think your voice is getting disturbed.
Yeah. Thank you. I distinguish on teacher and undisputed researcher and honorable resource person, Professor Dr. Amendra K. Ajay, Faculty of Medicine, Harvard Medical University, Associate Biologist, Brigham and Women's Hospital. Let me, to grace this occasion, let me acquaint you with the sterling quality of this eminent personality, who is a well-known academician. It is great pleasure for all of us that he could find time to be with us in spite of his busy schedule. I take this opportunity to convey my sincere thanks and gratitude to you and your management for accepting our request despite of your busy schedule and for being a valuable part of this International Virtual Learning Series. Sir, your prestigious presence, it is a great honor for us and great motivation and inspiration for our students. Today will further enthuse our students' career. Most welcome you, sir. Most welcome, sir.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, thank you, Principal, sir. Thank you, AKCP team members, Ambu sir.
Great, sir. Please, sir. It's a great thing, note that this session covers a wide range of interesting topics related to the lung and kidney application complications in patients with COVID-19.
Right.
Related to lung and kidney complications in patients with COVID-19. For our students, knowledge. So, dear students, utilize this great opportunity to explore your knowledge. Once again, it is a great pleasure for me to extend you all a very warm welcome. All the very best, my dear students. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Dr. Amendra K. Ajay, sir. Welcome, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you for giving a nice introduction about me. I'm very excited, and I would like to thank you all faculty members who are organizing this virtual learning for students. I think this is a great need of time to start this kind of virtual learning so that students can learn during this pandemic. I know everybody is hit by this pandemic, even learning people, teachers, faculty members and other people in the field are all affected, like research here has been impacted. So without delaying too much, I will start presentation and let me know the questions in between, or we can do question answer after that.
So at the end of the session.
Okay, that's good. So now then I will start with the lung. So as you, all of you know, COVID-19 is affecting and killing more people than expected. So the situation is evolving every day, and I will try to give you a sense of what is happening with lung and kidney complications, where we stand with the drug development, so that students can learn how a drug is developed for any disease, and what we where we stand with the vaccinations. So to give you some outline of my presentation, I'll be talking about three things. So my presentation outline will be introduction to COVID-19. I will be talking about virus in more details, then development of therapeutics and vaccines for COVID-19. And the last topic we'll be touching is lung and kidney complications in COVID-19 patients. So if you go back to the history, what we see is we can compare other outbreaks which were similar to COVID-19. It's not exactly the same, but I have listed some four viruses that has been involved in pandemic, which is SARS came in 2002, H1N1 in 2009, and MERS came in 2012, and COVID-19 came in 2019. So if you look at the death data, there were 800 deaths from SARS in 2002, 284,000 deaths in H1N1. MERS has 866 deaths, and COVID-19 is the highest one. Till today, there are 630,138 deaths. If you look at the infection rate, there were 8,000 in MERS, 7,62,00,000, and 2,500, and now this is 15,372,000. So I don't want to go into all details, but if you see, there are overall 5% death rate with a higher increase in rate of infection, and that's why it makes it more difficult to contain the disease right now. And we should be following all these guidelines that health professionals are giving us. If you think about the countries affected, so this, I will just compare this, H1N1 was 0.02% death. So it was not that mortal. Countries affected, 214 countries were affected by H1N1, and COVID-19 affected 215 countries. So this was also a very contagious disease, but the death rates were very low as compared to COVID-19. I just pulled up some data on India, USA, and China. So looking at the numbers today, so USA has 4,185 cases currently, and 146,000 deaths. The rate percentage death rate is 3.6%. In India, we have 1,239,684 cases and 29,890 deaths. This is 2.4%, which is encourageable. Like, we have a smaller death rate as compared to US and China. China has 80,000 cases, and there were 4,634 deaths. We can discuss in detail about these death rates if we require, but this is just to give you a snapshot of these three countries, because I live in USA, you live in India, and China is where it started. There is a whole kind of information available for all the countries. I'm not going to go into detail, but India stands on third position after USA and Brazil currently. So we, because of the population and maybe not properly controlled way, it is spreading to more and more people. And this is alarming. So I would emphasize that we should be careful. So I will go into the structure of the coronavirus. And in the left side, you can see this ball-like structure. This is the coronavirus, which is schematically represented. And on the right side, you can see the cut section of this virus, which is basically a ball cut into the half to expose the internal structures. And you see this yellow proteins are a spike protein. These are basically glycoprotein. These glycoproteins are very important because these proteins have glucose residue attached to this. And what glucose residue does is it makes this virus very sticky to any surface or to our body. And that's why one of the reason is that this is the reason why this is very contagious. In the middle of the core, you can see this pink structure, spiral structure, which is the RNA and the protein. And this is the genetic material because this is the RNA virus. There are viruses, as you know, which can be DNA or RNA, depending on the genetic material. So these all viruses that I talked were RNA viruses. And you can see this is the red structure, which is basically covering the virus. It's called envelope protein. Another protein I want to tell you is hematoglutinin esterase dimers. So these pin-like structure in the blue. And these are very important because this can basically clot our blood. And there has been many reports saying that patients who have died of COVID-19 have clotting in their bloods. So we'll discuss a little more about it in lung chapter. But this is giving you an overview of structure of the coronavirus. And as all of you know, but I just want to iterate it again, COVID-19 infections, how it spreads. So in the left side, you can see infected person with COVID-19, coronavirus 2, when he breathes, coughs, or sneezes, or in touch with someone else, there are droplets, small droplets that comes out of his mouth. And then another person who is next to him gets this virus. And this is how this virus is spreading from one to other. So I will tell you more about symptoms of COVID-19. And although this is a guidelines by the physicians, there are some asymptomatic cases which don't show any symptoms. So we have to be careful of those patients as well. So pneumonia, severe acute respiratory syndrome, kidney failure, death, cardiac injury, these all are major symptoms. But if you look at the symptoms which is visible to you, you can feel fever, cough, shortness of breath, and gastrointestinal problems, like you have diarrhea, dysentery. So all these are one of the features of COVID-19. So what happens is some of the patients get all these symptoms, some of the patients do not. So we have to be careful about it and think about it twice before being exposed to anything else. So there has been studies on coronavirus and how it is its infection is established in our body. And there is an enzyme, basically angiotensin converting enzyme ACE2, which has a receptor. And this receptor is present, ACE2, if you can see here, is present on the cell surface. I'll show you some pictures later how it is expressed by kidneys. But this is also expressed by lungs. So this ACE2, basically, this protein, SARS virus, S protein, which is spike protein, binds to these ACE receptors, and these are internalized by the cells. So once it is going in the cells, your cells are infected. And after this ACE2 receptor basically is recycled and ready for another virus, intaking the other virus into the body. And I will tell you more about is how this angiotensin receptor radiant system works. So if you look at this liver, which makes the angiotensinogen, and angiotensinogen is an proenzyme which is not active in function, and kidney makes it renin, which is basically an enzyme that cleaves angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1. And angiotensin 1 is converted into angiotensin 2, which is converted by ACE receptors. And why it is very important? Because angiotensin 2, I will tell you more, the next slide, is an enzyme that makes that keeps the blood pressure and keeps our arteries, as you can see, this is an artery, constricted to maintain the blood pressure. So if you look at this diagram, this is the vessel diagram. In the left side is the constricted vessels, which is normal. And on the right side, when we treat them with ACE inhibitor, so as I told you, ACE is basically keeps the vessels constricted and maintains the pressure. So what happens is when you use these, so ACE inhibitors are very commonly used for patients with high blood pressure, hypertension, and other cardiac complications. So what ACE inhibitors do is basically it relaxes the vessel, so it loses the pressure. So our vessels become thicker, and because of being it thicker, I mean relaxed, you see the lumen of the vessels gets bigger, and then the pressure inside becomes lower. So ACE inhibitors are basically high blood pressure lowering agents, and very commonly used. So in this case also, there were trials to inhibit the viral infection by ACE inhibitors. It was not very effective. So next, I will talk to you about development of therapeutics and vaccines for COVID-19. And we will start for the students, we will start with the drug development strategy for COVID-19. But I think students can learn a lot principally from how we approach a drug development for any disease. And I made it a little more basic so that our students can get benefit who want to pursue their career in drug development. So what we do is we choose a human or viral protein. So in this case, there are many proteins, but I will give you example of one of the human protein and one of the viral protein that is druggable. So we can tell that these proteins are druggable. So human protein is, as I told you, you can target ACE2 inhibitors where this virus binds and make a drug against it so that there's no infection. Other thing you can look is viral protein, like S3 protein. Can you target S3 protein or any other protein in the virus which can inhibit the replication? So S3 protein is for infection, but other viral proteins, I will tell you later, are for replication of the virus. So you can inhibit the replication of the virus. Once you decide on a protein, which is your drug candidate, you look at the molecular simulations to generate drug targets. So then you look at the protein structure is known. So you go to the computer and look at the drugs that can bind to this protein and which region it is binding and all those. Then you do virtual high throughput screening of the compound structure. So there are library which is available online, and you can look for the compounds that binds to these proteins. then you rank these potential compounds based on efficiency, like higher efficiency to lower efficiency. And then you go for experimental testing of top ranked compounds in mouse and cells. So then you do lab testing of not all the compounds because you have library around like 1 billion, approximately 1 billion compounds. So it is not possible to do it in the lab. So you would select either top 10 or top 5 candidates to test in the cells and mouse. And once those are positive in these experiments, then you perform clinical trials on patients with COVID-19 or the healthy volunteers to see the infection or to look at their recovery. So I will update you on what are the targets and what is the landscape of current target being investigated for therapeutics or vaccine production of COVID-19. So there are 2,588 ongoing trials as of today, which is registered to clinicaltrials.gov, and 448 are particularly on the lung and 32 on the kidney. And these trials are going up, but you can imagine within 3 months' time, there are so many advancements in clinical trials. And people are thinking of every aspect, how we can either spread, either inhibit the spread, or we can develop a therapeutic for this COVID-19. So I will give you more details about human protein that are targeting, being targeted, and ACE2 inhibitors, then TMPRSS2, which is another protein which is on the membrane, and that is being targeted for the treatment. Also, people are trying to see how we can treat the symptoms of the disease and what is specific about it. So like IL-6, which is a cytokine, inflammatory cytokine, which is released after infection. People are trying to inhibit it. And I think there are also some promising results on IL-6 inhibitor, which is an antibody that is given to the patients, critically ill patients, and they become better. Obviously, we can target fever, which is all the time the same medication that we are giving. Also, organ injury. So if you see the patients are having particular organ injury, we are targeting those organs so that that can be better. In terms of viral proteins, as I told you, we are also working on the establishment of infection and treatment of the infection after establishment. So like antibodies against spike proteins, so that spike protein cannot infect people, inhibitors against spike protein, but also to treat the symptoms of the disease. This is a protein called NSP15, which inhibits viral replication. So we are targeting that. But other than that, nuclear proteins like 6, 7, 10, 13, and ORFs, 3 and 8, these proteins are also being targeted to treat the symptoms of the disease. So I will brief you where we stand with the therapeutics today. And based on the clinical trials, remdesivir, which is a drug that was discovered for HIV treatment, is found to be effective by increasing the recovery rate and processing faster recovery. Dexamethasone, which is an anti-inflammatory drug, effective for COVID-19 treatment. And tocilizumab, which is an IL-6 and inhibitory antibody, is effective against critically ill patients and it protects from cytokine storm. Moderna therapeutic trial looks very promising and is just now in phase 3 clinical trials, and I'll give you more information about those trials. So recently, where we stand, and if you look at like 10-year, 20-year back, what are the viral disease and vaccine development landscape so that we can learn how much time in general it takes, and it can be quicker in our in COVID-19 because science and technology is getting advanced. And also I want to tell you one more thing which is good for students to know, that the drug development or virus or the vaccine development depends on the course of the disease. So if some disease is like affected in 10 days, so if you get symptoms in 10 days, it's very easy to and quick to do your trials and see the outcome. But some disease like cancer, it takes like 2 years to develop and look, get the biomarkers done. So that case, it becomes longer trials. So I have compared some of the similar virus that in this slide, and SARS, which was in 2003, H5N1, which was in 1996 and 2003. The drugs were developed pretty quickly, 2007, 13, and 2020. And Ebola, which came in 2018 recently, and 19, the drug was made. So Zika, 2015, there's no drug yet. MERS, there were no drugs. So no drug doesn't mean that there were no discoveries. There were discoveries, but the spread was not that big and it went away from the society. So there was no need for the drug to come in the market. So these orange structure are basically when the drug was developed. So it's with the COVID-19, we have started all these drugs and we will know in near future. So in general, it takes like a year, something like that, to get the drug approved and do all the clinical trials beforehand. So we are very hopeful with the with this vaccine trials, and I will update you more on COVID-19 trials. So these are the candidate names. I don't think this means a lot for us because these are all coded by the company. But what makes us exciting is this tells you what are the mechanism of virus. So these are basically mRNA that is injected into the healthy volunteers. And this Moderna is in phase, they have completed phase 2 trials and they are starting phase 3 early in August. So this is mRNA vaccine, which is encoding S proteins. There are three companies in China. They have also completed phase 2 trials. And as you can see, their trials are going slower now because there are less patients there. So they're stuck to the phase 2 now. And these are basically different approach. They have adenovirus vector, which is expressing S protein. And there's also DNA plasmid that is encoding S protein and is delivered by electroporation. And there are also some of the dendritic cells that can basically kill these virus in the body. So this company called Shenzhen Genoimmune Medical Institute, they are doing these trials. Recently, last week, you might have seen that mRNA-based vaccine by Pfizer got phase 2 clinical trial successfully done, and they are entering into phase 3 now, which is also encouraging. There is another trial from Oxford University, which is basically, so you inactivate the virus and those virus cannot infect you, but when this is put in the body, it can activate your immune system and makes the antibody against it. So this virus was this inactivated virus was getting a lot of attention because it increases the immunity against this virus. And this is in phase 3 clinical trial currently. And with these advancements, I think we are very hopeful that one or two or all might be approved by FDA for the vaccine targets. Next, I will tell you more about what happens to lung and kidney when these patients are infected with COVID-19. And I will just first tell you more about lung injury, and then we'll move to kidney injury. So if you look at this diagram, in the left side, first diagram you see is a normal lung. So this is in the left side, you can see this arteries, which brings the blood which is not oxygenated. And this oxygenated blood, non-oxygenated blood goes into the lungs, capillary and alveolar cells. And this is then gets oxygenated by the oxygen that we breathe in. And the oxygen, carbon dioxide is taken out from the blood here, and we exhale that. So this is the normal physiology, but when there's an infection of the virus here, you can see that these microcapillaries, these are basically broken up by these virus. And then what happens is, you can see that there's no direct blood flow, or there's an obstruction in the blood flow. And what happens is the flow is already going continuously. So the thicker vessels are being made here. You can think about this vessel is thicker. So they merge together and make into a thicker blood vessels. And you can see here there are some more thickening. And ultimately what happens is there's a bypass which is made because of the flow of the blood, and these thick membranes, thick vessels are formed, but all these smaller vessels are completely dying. And you can imagine that now we have the oxygen exchanging capacity, which is just one vessel instead of very smaller vessels. So what happens is then you don't have oxygen exchanging capability, which was higher in your normal lung. Now it is reduced to one or two vessels. So that is a problem because we don't get enough oxygen exchange. And once this happens, then we try to put more oxygen because the surface area of the effective surface area of the lungs in terms of the oxygen exchange has been reduced. So we want to force oxygen to the higher concentration, and that's why we put these patients on ventilator so they can get more oxygen, and there will be more effective exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide here, and we'll get more oxygen in the body. So then patients are on ventilator. So this is a histology for the lung that you see. So the figure A shows you a normal lung, which has nice epithelial cells and other structures, you can see nicely. And in the B, you see how these cells are basically broken up. You don't see any cells here. You see a lot of injury here, and the cells are crumbled up together. So this is injured by COVID-19 infection. And if you see at the later stage, you see this kind of cast formation, which is basically inhibiting the oxygen exchange. Which is not a cell, which are not the cells. These are kind of deposits, which is present everywhere in the lung. And you can see the enlarged view here. These casts look like this bigger chunk of deposited material on the lung. So this all impacts the lung capability to exchange the oxygen. If you look at the structure at higher magnification, you can see that these are basically another study done by people in the lung. And these red thing that you can see, these are red blood cells, but these are the thrombus that is formed inside the lung. So thrombus is kind of obstruction that stops the blood flow in the lung, and that causes injury to the even lungs other than other organs, because other organs might not get enough oxygen. So other organs get other injuries, but even lungs, because some of these portions don't get enough oxygen, So they get ischemic and hypoxia and the tissue dies. This is a work which was for the first time showing that what happens to the vascular damage if you look at the vasculature in the lungs. And in this figure A, you can see that there is a, these are the vessels that is in the lungs. And in the B, you can see these vessels are basically ruptured. You can see structures are not very smooth as in A. And as I was telling you, this may be because of the hematoglutinin which clots the blood, and also it cleaves some of the surface proteins and makes these vessels ruptured. In the C and D are basically enlarged image of this this structure, and you can see that there are pores in the vessels that is being made. So what happens is these vessels are actually very tightly packed, and there is no leakage. But when we see these holes is made by the virus, there's a leakage of the blood, and that causes sudden death. And this is one of the major reasons why people are dying of COVID-19, because of the vasculature leakage. And this is showing you the same structure. Like, these are the virus, these are spots, which is arrows, are the virus inside the vessels. We are seeing it in a high magnification scanning electron microscopy. So then I will tell you the last topic, kidney injury caused by COVID-19. And this slide summarizes what is the extent of kidney injury. So kidney injury can be acute, as acute lung injury, or it can be chronic. So for chronic, it develops in 1 or 2 years. So we don't have the data yet, because this has not passed 1 or 2 years. But for AKI, which is acute kidney injury, we have the data. And people have studied various aspects, and 0.5 to 23% of the patients have AKI. And in New York, they observed 40% of the patients having AKI, and as much as 9% of the people were needed the renal replacement therapy, which is basically the you can say kidney transplant. So 9% of the patients were transplanted with a new kidney. This is more common in ICU settings, because ICU settings, as you know, there are more critical patients. So 88% of the people were in ICU settings were having AKI versus 2% outside. And of course, this was because of other abnormalities like albuminuria, which is basically excretion of the albumin in the urea, which is a measure of kidney function. So 34% of the patients were having albumin in their urine. Overall proteinuria means other kind of proteins were excreted in the urine, which is 63%. And in general, we don't see urine in the protein because kidney filters it out. Hematuria, which is 26%. This is a condition where you see blood coming in the urine, and that is because of the kidney damage or infection. And both of these were like 44%. So, of course, there are more complications if you think about cardiovascular disease, which is 40%. 48% of the CKD. If somebody has chronic kidney disease, they have 48% mortality. Diabetes, which is up to 20%. And hypertension, which is 33%. So these all conditions affect the kidney injury more. So what, there was a study that showed that 30% of the COVID-19 patients saw kidney injury. And what they did is they did take out 22 patients, and they looked at the SARS-CoV-2 mRNA copies, in different organs, lungs, pharynx, heart, kidney, liver, brain, and blood. And they did the RT-PCR, which is a method to detect protein, detect mRNA, and you can choose one gene or two genes from the virus, and you can amplify those to know how many copies are there by doing serial dilution. And they found that this color red shows you 600 copies, which is more in lung, of course. Pharynx was the second highest organ, but kidney was the fourth highest organ that has increased number of COVID-19 virus. And they also did some of the in situ hybridization. So what you do is, so the first image on the top right is showing you the immunohistochemistry. So what you do is you pick antibody that binds to the virus, and then on the tissue sections, you stain those with the virus, and then you detect these with the color secondary antibody, which is colored. And this red color is showing the virus. So you can see these many virus are present in the lung, and there are also more present in the kidney. So this is detecting the virus in the tissues by actual virus by immunocytochemistry. They also did some immunofluorescence. So immunofluorescence is a technique where you can basically detect two proteins at a time, and that will give you an idea where it is in the cells or the tubule. So suppose if you are looking at a cell structure, you can see if it is in the nucleus or in the cytoplasm or on the membrane by co-staining with two proteins. One will be your cellular marker, another will be your COVID-19 virus protein. So in the lung, what they found is they are in the cytoplasm. So this white structures are basically nucleus, which is DNA. And this is around the nucleus, as you can see in these two. In the second panel, what they have done is they have done this staining for virus, viral protein, and also co-staining for nephrine. So nephrine is a protein which is expressed in the glomerulus. And what they are saying is this is in the glomerulus. If you see here again, it is showing you the same thing in the glomerulus. These viruses are in the glomerulus, surrounded by the nephrine protein. And here they are saying that they also stand for nephrine, but here they don't see any nephrine. So they are saying that this is a tubular structure, and these viruses are also in the tubules of the kidney. So this study finds that SARS-CoV-19 virus infects the tubular cells, and they have autopsies from 26 COVID-19 patients. They saw that there are RBC aggregates. So these are brownish structures, are basically aggregates that is formed in the kidney. And same thing like lungs, kidney also has very good vasculature. So it damages vasculature once there is a thrombosis. Filtering of the urines cannot be done so efficiently, and that causes injury. Also the blood flow becomes obstructed, and that causes injury and ischemia to the kidney, which basically causes injury overall to the kidney and other organs. Electron microscopy also shows that viruses are in, so this is a structure called glomerulus. You can identify by a ground structure. There are viruses here, and also in the tubules, you can see this is a tubular structure, and there are viruses there. So they also did some immunostaining to detect the virus, and this yellow structure, they are saying that these are virus, and these are nicely localized in the tubules. As you can see, these tubules, and some of these tubules, they are claiming that these are dead tubules. So tibular injury is very common in patients with COVID-19. And why this is so important? Because I wanted to tell you about this expression of ACE2 inhibitors, which is also in lungs and pharynx, but also if you look at the kidney, you see that, so this is a normal kidney and this is a diabetic kidney on the right. So in the left side, the normal kidney also have significant amount of brown color, which is basically the immunohistochemistry for ACE2 receptor. And you can see that this is a glomerulus. There's enough protein in the glomerulus. And these are the tubules, and it is expressed in the tubules as well. But after diabetes, you can see that ACE2 is expression is increased significantly in the tubules. And this might be one of the reasons why they might have more copies of coronavirus in these patients with diabetes. So what are the precautions? Precautions you know much better than me, but I will give you an example of people who are at the higher risk and who has more underlying conditions and how they can be safe. So first is like always you wear a mask when you are expecting somebody close to you or when you are outside. People who are 65 age and older are at higher risk. People with chronic lung disease or asthma, they are at higher risk. People with cardiac failure or other disease, cardiac disease have higher risk. Definitely kidney disease patients have higher risk. Immunocompromised people who are basically infected with AIDS and other immunological disease are at high risk. Cancer survivors, diabetes, hypertension, and obesity. These are the major high-risk people, and I think they should be more careful than everybody else because they get complication and there are higher mortality rate for these people. And with that, I would like to thank you, the team, and stay safe, stay home, and I'll be happy to take the questions.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. We had a very useful and informative discussion, sir. Any questions?
Excuse me, sir.
Sure, yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah, I am Dr. V. Shivakumar.
Sure.
I just got a question regarding fenofibrate, sir. Fenofibrate, now there is a cure that is they are saying that is a, it is taken as a cure that COVID-19 can be converted into a simple cold, just like a simple cold, because it inhibits the protein, that is lipid metabolism, in lungs, particularly lung cells. And hence, the infection can be reduced drastically.
Yes, but so there were, yes, that is true. So people are trying different drugs that is already in the market, and if it can be repurposed for this treatment. So they are doing the clinical trials. I think there are some benefits to the patients, and I think once it gets approved from the FDA, it will be a drug for these patients. And fenofibrate is also helpful because this fenofibrate is also kind of inhibits the infection and also it helps in lipid metabolism.
Okay, sir. And another one thing, melatonin. The another one drug, melatonin, it is also being repurposed because it is, if it is given as an adjuvant, it is also increasing the immunity as well as it is reducing the interleukins IL-6, IL-10 and IL-4.
Right. So,
and yeah, so there are, These two drugs are being practiced in Boston, sir. Fenofibrate and melatonin.
No, so we are not practicing any of this drug, which is not approved. So US has a different kind of rule. So once they complete the clinical trial, then only these drugs will be given to the patients in general. So they are in clinical trials and given to the patients who are enrolled in the clinical trial.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Oh, thank you.
Sir, good morning, sir.
Good morning.
This is Dr. Raja Gandhi from faculty of AKCP.
Good, thank you.
Sir, vascular damage is one of the major root cause of death in COVID-19, as you said, sir.
Right.
So, vascular damage, vascular leakage is happening only in lungs, in all over the body, sir?
All over the body, actually. But intensity is higher in lungs because lungs get more viral load. It is happening everywhere. All the vasculature is affected, and especially the microvasculature is more prone than the bigger vasculature. So that is basically in the organs where you see some organs have smaller vasculature, which is more, and some have less. So whatever organ like kidney and lung has more smaller microvasculature. So those are disrupted.
Thank you.
But it affects all the vasculature in general.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Sir, there is a question in the chat box. A patient by Mr. Subhas, final B form. A patient who are recovered from COVID-19 also have lung trouble even if he recovers. Is this true? And opinion, what is your opinion on this?
Yes, so that is true. I did not touch upon that topic, but this is a very good question. If you look at the patients, I did not show you any image, but these patients have a chronic lung injury, which has been seen in patients who have recovered. So they have this fibrotic regions in their lungs, which is irreversible. So fibrotic regions are basically the cells that have been died and the matrix has been laid up on that particular region. So those are kind of dead tissue and very stiff to the other work. So that makes it permanent kind of damage to the kidney, to the lungs, and even in the kidneys. There are less studies in the kidney, but this is very true for soft organ. When there is a kind of fibrotic area, the organ loses the function, and that loss is permanent, and there is no cure for now. So depending on that, some of the COVID patients may have like 20%, 30%, 40% loss of the lung capability, and that can remain for a long time because there is no reversal therapy for that.
Thank you, sir. Sir, why that coronavirus has more impact on lungs and kidneys? Sir? There is any specific reason for that, sir?
So there are mainly two reasons. One is these organs are very vascularized, and these organs are very important for, one, if you think about lungs, they are very important for oxygen exchange. So if you have a problem in getting oxygen to the body, you can breathe, but even if it is not exchanged to the blood, so all the blood is basically having less oxygen, and that causes injury to many other organs as well and cells, because we are not getting enough oxygen. So that is the main root cause. In terms of the kidney has very good vasculature, and if those vasculature is disrupted by these virus, then the filtering capability of these, so virus is also cleared by kidney. So if we see that there is thrombosis in the kidney, then there will be no viral clearance, and all the nitrogenous waste which should be excreted out by the kidney, because the kidney is not functioning properly, so they build up in the body, and that build up actually is lethal to people, to all the organs. Suppose like blood urea nitrogen or serum creatinine, which has to be excreted out to, so that it doesn't get toxic to our body. So that develops in the blood, and blood circulates to the whole body, and all the organs are affected. So this is a loop that keeps going with these patients.
Thank you, sir.
That's clear. Yeah.
There is a question from Raghavendran.
Sure.
Diagnosis of COVID based on its symptoms. He is mentioning that that COVID symptoms are similar to other common diseases. How to differentiate that?
Yeah, so this is a critical question even for clinicians. I think if you think about fever, simple question, like if you have a fever, if you treat the fever, you will get less damage to the body, because you are so you know that some of the fever which is high enough can cause problem to the brain, trauma to the brain and other organs. So if you treat the fever, in general you are basically protecting your body and body organs. So that is the concept that people are following here in this case, that symptoms might be similar, but we should contain that symptom so that the patient doesn't get worse. So sometimes you know, like some fevers get, if you treat them earlier or very with a good drug, you don't need to go to hospital. But sometimes even fever can lead you to the admission in the hospital. So basically they are trying to treat these symptoms with the drug that we already have, which might not be specific to COVID-19, but for that symptom. Like suppose you have dysentery or diarrhea, as I told you, one of the symptoms. If you lose excessive fluid, then you are going to have more complications and your body will not respond to other things. So the idea is to become stronger in terms of the health and reduce the symptoms that you are having that can cause secondary complications too.
Thank you, sir. There is a question from Mr. Abhishek. Dexamethasone is a corticosteroid and it has been used as immunosuppressant and immunomodulator. How it can be used for COVID-19?
Yeah, so it is a you're right, Abhishek, this is a corticosteroid and it also acts as immunosuppressant. But dexamethasone is also very well known anti-inflammatory molecule. And that's why it is used to treat the COVID-19 patients who is having this cytokine storm, or they also have this inflammatory mechanism that is very significantly upregulated in these patients. So to treat those inflammation and cytokine storm, basically burst of IL-6 and other cytokines, dexamethasone is being used for the patients of COVID-19.
Thank you, sir. There is a question by Ms. Naveena, third from D. As you said, COVID-19 caused lung scars. There is a chance of increasing lung cancer, sir. Lung scars leads to lung cancer.
We don't have any data on this right now, whether this scarring can cause lung cancer or not. But other way around is possible. Like people have shown that if somebody has lung cancer, in the core of the tumor, you see fibrosis, because those are the cells which are more hypoxic and they die and form a scar. So that is possible, but I think I need to look more details into scarring and cancer.
Thank you, sir. There is a question from Mr. Raghavendra. Corona haven't affected animals like human. How the animal trial can be conducted for vaccinations?
How? So animals have been also affected. But if you think about the process of vaccination, they are just trying to see if this particular vaccine, candidate vaccine, is producing immune response in the mice or not. So these mice are basically not infected from the beginning. They are the clean mice without infection, and then they use this vaccine agent to inject in these mice, and then they look at the immune response antibody basically for this for the particular protein. And they also have the control mice which are not infected to compare. So this is a comparative trial, saying that the mice or the rats which were infected with this vaccine product was having the immune response by looking at the different kind of immunoglobulins.
Thank you, sir. There is a question from Mr. Harikaran. Does BCG vaccine is useful for treating COVID-19, sir?
There have been some trials. I think in USA, we have not found it very effective. So in USA, we are not giving it here. But I think some studies we are showing that in Australia, they have better results. In India, of course, we have less death rate than USA. So that might be one of the reasons. And it also depends on when this BCG vaccine was given. So suppose we were given like 4 doses of vaccine during our childhood. So that might have more kind of immune response than just one dose right now. So that also is a consideration that some of the patients which were having BCG vaccine long back, 3 or 4 doses of the vaccines, might be immune to some of this COVID-19, but there's no clear data in USA that we can tell you clearly.
Okay, thank you, sir. If you see the chicken box, prevent the chicken box, vaccines are there, but still those who are immunated, they are getting chicken box. The same thing will be applicable for this corona also, sir?
Right, so that
with
is true for...
strain or mutated strain.
Right, you are right. So there are always a chance that this virus mutates, and sometimes these vaccines are also not 100% effective. So you have some kind of immunity, but it cannot protect you. So for that case, I'll give you an example of even influenza. So we get these flu shots every year here in USA, and that is based on the fact that every year there are new strains that is coming for the flu virus. But still people get sick and when people die. So it's not, as you said, that's a very good point. It will reduce the infection rate, but how much we don't know yet.
Sir, here in COVID-19 centers, they are using pulse oximeter to detect the condition of the patient, sir, that blood oxygen level.
Mm-hmm.
Whether the blood oxygen level really indicate the condition of the patient, sir?
No, so blood oxygen level can be basically misleading for now, because if somebody has asthma, somebody has other lung conditions or some other disease, they will also have reduced oxygen level in the blood. So it all depends on what other complications they have. It's not just COVID-19, and COVID-19 also, if you think about, many patients might not show any decrease because their lung is not that much affected. So if you think about a critical patients who is having a lot of problem with breathing and all those people will show you the oxygen level is low because their lungs are very highly infected. But there are many patients who don't get to that level. And in that case, we might not see a reduced oxygen level in their body.
Thank you, sir.
Hey, mighty.
Sir, one final question, sir. So last week, WHO announced that corona is airborne. It's airborne. Like previously told, it's a droplet infection. Now it has been concluded like it's airborne, sir. And we are getting a lot of information from government, ICMR itself also, regarding the mask, what you have to use, like cotton mask, N95 mask. Yesterday we received news like that N95 mask is ineffective against COVID-19. So ICMR advised citizens to use cotton mask for better prevention. So can you elaborate what are the preventive methods to overcome this corona, sir?
Yeah, so people, I think mask, using a mask is a great thing, I think. I will support using the mask. If you have N95 versus like cotton mask, people use cotton mask because I think that is, people are saying that this is more safe nowadays. So cotton mask or the normal mask that you can buy from the store without N95. I think N95 mask is more for the doctors who are... In the hospital, what instructions we get is N95 is more for the doctors who are dealing with the patients so that they don't get infected. But N95, of course, it doesn't save you that much from the airborne disease. And it has been, I think if you look at the data, now even in USA, in Massachusetts, where the Boston is, this state has hit hard initially. But now people are using, most of the people are following the mask rule. So they are getting, the infections are, rates are really low, 200 cases per day, 300 cases per day. But if you go to South, where people are not following that mask rule, they are hit hard right now. And they are approximately like 4,000, 5,000 people in a state every day is becoming positive. So I think mask is a good way of protection. At least even if some viral particles are in the air or in the droplets, it cannot come to you. And other than that, washing your hands because we are touching the same surfaces like elevators and other things, washing hands all the time so that we don't inhale any virus. It's a good practice.
Excuse me, sir. Sir, am I audible?
Yes.
Actually, SARS-CoV-2 is a third virus in the coronavirus. Actually, SARS in 2002 and MERS in 2010. Still, why there is no vaccine for SARS and MERS? And how can we expect a vaccine for SARS-CoV-2, sir?
Yeah, that's, as we discussed, I was showing you one of the slides that why it might not be in the market. Because if you think about MERS, those were infected in, like I think 800 people were died. And then the virus did not spread to other people. So there was no need of vaccination, although there was research that has been done and there were candidates that were positive for very positive to increase the immune response against those viruses, but there was no disease. So how it works is no pharma company will make those vaccine if there's no market later on. So that's why those were not made and given to the patients because there was no need. So same thing might happen even like in a year, if there is no SARS-CoV-2 infections, then there will be no interest in the vaccination, right? But if it keeps coming up every year in a cycle or continuously, then the pharma industry will make the vaccines.
Okay,
Sir, there is a question by Mr. Tenmuli.
So,
there is any need to take any kind of test after recovery from COVID to monitor the organ function?
Yeah, so that is a very good question. People do that. People take, there are like very easy tests and cheaper tests for kidney function, liver function, cardiac functions. You can take your hypertension, like blood pressure and everything. Which is good to have all those tests done so that you are aware that either people who are who have recovered have all these organ function at the maximum, or if they are having some problem with some of the organs, and they can be careful about that. Suppose if somebody has see that their lung function is not 100%, then they can be careful about go like being asthmatic or any other disease like infection that can cause lung injury, because that will enhance his risk of getting the lung function worse and worse. So it's a good idea to take the test if you can afford. It's good to take all the tests and know about your somebody's body, what is has gone wrong.
So one final question, sir.
Sure.
So, sir, what is the incubation period for corona, sir, COVID-19, sir? Because initially the people has been quarantined for 14 days, then 10 days. Now they are kept quarantined for 7 days only. So if there is any changes in the incubation period, sir?
No. So the general, in general, the thing is like you might not know when it was you got infected, right? So until unless you do the test every day. So in general, doctor says that here the guidelines is you might see a symptom in 2 to 14 days. So according to the guidelines here in USA, people say to be in incubation for 14 days. And if you don't see any symptoms coming up, then you can be COVID-19 free, even if you get a symptom without any symptoms. Even if you get infection without any symptoms. So 14 days is a very critical time here.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Students, any other questions? So there is a question from Ms. Navina, third from me. There is a information that vaccines are the COVID-19 vaccines are made from fetal cells. Is that true?
What is that? I don't get you.
She told that the COVID-19 vaccines are being made from fetal cells.
No, that's not right. So these vaccines will be made in a facility where you will have synthesis of basically amplifying the mRNA or protein. So making in a manufacturing facility of any of these big pharma companies. So they will not be using, they might be using some of the cells, not the fetal cells, but any other cells, which is very well known to produce the protein. Most of the times they use HCK293 cells, which are human embryonic kidney cells. But those are not directly taken out from the fetus. They are the cell lines that have been made and they are being used every time. So you're not killing a new fetus for making these protein or RNA, mRNA.
Thank you, sir. Any other questions?
Thank you, Professor. Dr. Amendra K. Ajay, sir.
Oh, thank you, sir, for a nice company.
Yeah. On behalf of our management of Arulmigu Kalasalingam College of Pharmacy, hereby express my wholehearted thanks to you and your university for such a wonderful and informative presentation, sir. In future also, one request, sir. In future also, let's have a good collaboration, sir.
Sure. I'm happy to do the collaborations in future. Thank you so much. We'll keep this continue. Okay.
Sure, sir. Take care, sir. Take care.
Okay. Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Thank you.